Good evening and welcome to the Thursday, August 11th, 2016 meeting of the Northampton School Committee. I'm Mayor David Narkowitz, chairing the meeting, and I'll begin by asking the clerk to call the roll of the school committee.
Here.
Present.
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 Present. Thank you very much. First item on our agenda is the public comment period. Is there anyone who wishes to speak during the public comment? Okay, seeing none, we'll move on to announcements from members of the school committee. Any announcements? Oh, Dr. Baird.
So I want to thank the mayor for coming and reading at the Ryan Road Summer Reading Program. I think that was this week, correct?
Summer Reading Olympics, yes.
And the last big event is the 30th at 6 o'clock with Police Chief Casper joining to be our featured reader. And so everybody should come check it out.
That's right.
I would like to remind everyone that on August 23rd, that's a Tuesday, at 4 o'clock in the afternoon is Trans Performance, which is an arts event, which I believe some PTOs maybe sell concessions, and there's some other things that are connected to the whole community. So that's another fun community event, Tuesday, August 23rd.
Any other announcements? Okay, hearing none, we'll now move into recommended actions, and we have a consent agenda this evening that consists of the minutes of the school committee meeting of April 14th, 2016, the negotiating subcommittee meeting of July 11th, 2016. We also have two transfers, Jackson Street budget transfer to purchase student workbooks and a technology budget transfer to purchase new servers. We also have a field trip request, Ryan Road fifth grade going to Nature's Classroom in Beckett, Massachusetts, November 7th through the 10th, 2016.
Move to approve the recommended actions under the consent agenda.
Okay, is there, and there's a second by Ms. Fallon. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, so the consent agenda is approved. Next item on the agenda, we have the annual food service report, and Mr. Tranfaglia is here to present that.
Hello, everybody. Thank you very much for having me today. Today, I'm doing the annual report for the food service program for last year, and I really wanted to start out by saying thank you to the district for providing me with the support and trust to perform my responsibilities with confidence and creativity. It was a fun year last year. I really enjoyed the challenge of coming into the district and getting to know all of you and everybody that works within the district. I'm very excited for the future growth of the food service program and how it will continue to develop as an important part of students, parents, faculty, and staff and the community's nutritional needs. I feel that I've made a lot of good contacts over the past year, reaching out to different families and opening up communication more and more every day as we went along the school year. My staff has been an incredible part of the successful year that we had. From the first day, they listened to everything that I had to say. They offered their suggestions and comments without restriction. They didn't hold back, sometimes good, sometimes not, but it's always a benefit to hear exactly what they have to say, and that really helped out quite a bit with everything that we had to do throughout the year. There was a lot of changes that we put into place. It was their willingness to accept me as part of their team that has created an environment that helped develop the path of a very successful school year. This was always key to me, this last statement. My trust in them and their trust in me is what drives the success of our department. I think that's very important. I could feel that as we went along and they started to see the successes that we had and the way in which we communicated with each other, that they started to trust me, and of course I started to trust them quite a bit. Now on to the good details of my report. I say good details because it was a good year. I really enjoyed it. Participation. As you see in the document in front of you, participation for this year, a lot of what you'll be hearing me say is we increased a little bit, we increased a lot. That's a good path for where we're looking to go. Starting back in FY 13, 14, and 15, we saw a decline in the amount of lunches that we offered. We had a slow increase, a small increase, a little less than 3,000 for last year, which is a positive move in the right direction. The big piece is the breakfast. We went up just under 5,500 breakfast for last year. I spoke with Dr. Provost today, and we had a little discussion about what caused that. I honestly can't take the credit for it, but I'd like to say that we did have a little bit more information out to parents about the breakfast program, either on menus and in conversation. We'll continue to keep working on that. That's a project of mine this year. And Dr. Provost and I had a small conversation and started the preliminaries of discussion about offering a second choice breakfast. A second choice breakfast would definitely help increase the numbers, but also offer a better way in which students can get breakfast in the morning. Lunch participation last year was 37%. We went up to 38% this year. Breakfast participation was 5%. We went up 6% this year. You start to look at enrollment numbers, and you can see enrollment numbers were up a little bit, but as you start to move and look at numbers, you can say, okay, what's the percentage of the actual participation? And it's right in line with where the actual increases came from. But also I feel that having new items out there, looking at product a different way, some students were getting a little bit more excited about purchasing school lunch and then talking with parents also. So I think as we start moving forwards and talking with parents more, students more, getting more input from them, I'm optimistic that numbers will continue to go up. The finances was the key for me this year. Of course, we all look at finances and we want to make sure how the program is actually operating. FY 13, 14, and 15, once again, you saw a decline in numbers. And this year, I was able to add to our revolving account balance $22,000. A lot of that came from utilizing commodities in a different way, which was quite a big difference. We utilized $30,000 worth of commodities as opposed to the year before. We also purchased a lot less food because of that usage of commodities. And inventory was a big key this year. I really worked with staff and they really paid attention on inventory and trying to keep inventory low. So that really assisted in making sure that we had a nice balance at the end of the school year. Makes me very happy. Free and reduced enrollment. The district was up from last year. Last year was 31.75%. This year it's at 33.82%. And in discussions trying to figure out why that went up, had a couple different things that stuck out. One thing that's happening is we use a program called the Virtual Gateway. It's called Direct Certification, where we get quite a bit of those, capture those students that need free and reduced lunches. That program and that website is getting better and better at capturing from all areas. Years ago, those numbers were low. As we start moving forward, they get a little bit higher and higher. The good thing about seeing this going up a little bit is that I feel that we're doing a good job at trying to make sure we get out to parents and get out to the students that we do offer free and reduced lunch. Just tonight, I was talking to a bunch of different parents, calling them and assisting them with their free and reduced application. I think that's a big key because some people just don't understand it. They look at the numbers, that the chart, and they say, I don't qualify, but they may not have all the answers. So I'm going to try even harder to make sure I get information out to parents so that they clearly understand how they could qualify for it. Uncollected student debt. This is always a hot topic. It was a hot topic throughout the school year. We tried very, very hard at trying to collect student debt on school lunches. At the end of the fiscal year last year, the debt was at $4,600, a little more than that. And the way that it works is the state and the federal government says that we can't carry any debt, that it has to be paid for by non-federal funds, in which case the non-federal funds come from the operating budget. So we received a payment last year of $4,665.92. that doesn't clear out the debt that students owe. So I wanted to make sure that that's clear so parents know it. The school lunch program can't carry the debt, but we can still maintain a list and still try to collect funds from parents. And I think that's the big key, and we try very hard at doing that. How do we try? We did robocalls, we sent letters home with students, we mailed letters, we sent home certified letters if they owed a certain dollar amount, we emailed parents, and for the higher balances, we actually made personal phone calls to those parents. One thing that I wanted to point out is that as the student debt continues to rise, we may want to revisit the discussion about a possible lunch charging cap being implemented. And I know that was a topic a few years ago, but it might be something that we should look at as we move forwards. The reason that I bring that up is I just did some numbers today looking at student debt, and there's 17 students who hold $4,400 worth of the debt for this year. So 17 students, $4,400. FY16, we ended the student debt at $6,211.71. Throughout the school year, we collected, and please ask questions if this gets a little confusing, but during the school year, we collected $2,333.45 of the debt from the year before. So we apply that credit to what was owed at the end of this year in the district operating budget payment to the food service program for this year was $3,878. So the discussion should come up at some point. Another piece of this is that currently there's no school committee charge policy in place. The federal regulations mandate that a formal charge policy must be created by the district and accepted by the school committee. When I get reviewed, they're going to ask to see, and it's actually titled, "What is your charge policy?" And they want to have a policy handed to them that they can clearly see. Now, we have the ability to set whatever that looks like. They don't assist us at all in that piece. So we could say $100, $500, $1,000, whatever it might be. But it's just something to think about as we start moving forward, and I just wanted to put that in the back of your minds as we start going. School lunch pricing. School lunch pricing is $2.75. It is $1.25 for breakfast. Each year, the government gives us a little chart and lets us know what we should be charging for school lunch pricing. This year, for 2016-2017, the government says that that amount is set at $2.78. So we're a touch below that. But because we receive a $40,000 what I classify as a non-federal funds to the school lunch program, again, non-federal funds, we can keep the school lunch pricing at $2.75 for this year, $1.25 for breakfast. But every year that amount goes up a little bit, and at some point, the discussion should be talked about whether or not we decide to raise school lunch pricing. When you ask around and you talk to other districts and you see what their school lunch pricing is at, it's always a tricky animal because it's all over the place. But then you have to find out what type of non-federal funds are being applied to offset that or what they're doing in order to get their lunch prices to meet that guideline. Food purchasing and bid process. Last year when I came in, we were using state bids, and we were also using independent city procurement practices. After doing a little bit of searching around and talking to a lot of people, I looked at joining the Collaborative for Educational Services purchasing group, and we decided to go with that purchasing practice for this current school year. And the reason why is, as after I evaluated the cost savings of some of the products that we purchased large quantities of, and I'll have a little example here, that I found that we could have a significant savings as part of the CES. And just as a quick little example, last year we paid 25 cents for a carton of chocolate milk. For the Joining the CES purchasing group for this year, it's at 21 cents. And I know the milk market fluctuates a little bit, but it's very consistent on what was being paid for last year. We actually serve close to 100,000 cartons of milk, chocolate milk, a year. It's almost 142,000 cartons of milk in the course of a year. And it's funny when parents hear that number, they go, you serve what? 142,000 cartons? And you look at how many lunches we actually serve, and that's where it's at. But you look at the estimated savings, and it's close to that, that one item, just one item, we could save $4,000. Or not could, will, for next year. And looking at items like pizza and chicken nuggets and even some produce items, I'll start to see a much greater savings building up. And I'm actually excited to come back to you at some point to be able to share those numbers with you. Excuse me. Northampton High School improvements. This is the item that I'm most excited about for two reasons. Northampton at the high school at the end of May, the district was at 22% school lunch participation, which is the lowest in our district by a lot. And quite honestly, what I bet most districts around from all the different directors I talked to, it's below that number that they have. We're gonna try a bunch of different things next year. Our goal of the nutrition department is to create an environment at Northampton High School cafeteria that will encourage and promote students to participate in the school lunch program. We are in the process of creating an atmosphere within the serving area that is reflective to a college setting. And if you get a chance, please take a peek in the servery area at the high school. It's really looking sharp. It came from more of a hospital neutral type setting to now there's color all over the place. Big signs are being hung up everywhere. We're gonna be turning basically that whole servery area over to the art department. Of course, I haven't talked with the art department yet, but I'm sure they'll be excited about it, so that they'll be able to have an art gallery throughout that servery area and however they would like to utilize that space. Also, all of the vending machines that were on the inside wall at the high school servery area, we pulled those all out and we're putting in high top tables that are about 36 inches around. There's six of them that are going to be going along that wall, so students can come in, and if they'd like to just stand around and have breakfast in the morning or at lunchtime, they're welcome to do that. But the biggest key that we're doing for next year is, in the past, we opened for breakfast and we closed for breakfast and the doors were shut. Next year, we're opening those doors up and they're staying open until the last cafeteria person leaves, which is around 1 o'clock. So that students throughout the day, if they'd like to get something from the cafeteria, they don't have to go to a vending machine, they can actually purchase it through us. And you say, okay, well, what are they going to be purchasing through us? We're going to be bringing in just about 100 different a la carte items. Over the past few years, if you wanted to buy an apple, I'm not going to say that they wouldn't allow it, but they didn't have a method in order to do it. So next year, or should I say this year, this school year, they were going to have that way and possibility to be able to purchase quite a bit of product that all meet the guidelines. Everything will meet the guidelines. But we're also going to set it up so that if a student or a faculty member wants to come in and just buy a sandwich, they can just buy a sandwich. They want to just buy the baked fries that we have that day, they can just buy the baked fries. The thought process behind it is to get the students to be able to utilize the cafeteria for a place and a space that they're comfortable in, that they can grab a quick bite to eat, that they're not purchasing as much through a vending machine. Although those items are good, we will have some of those items available, but the vending machines will mostly be used for after school students that are staying later throughout the day, at nighttime, weekends, and to whatever that degree.
Can you explain to me, are the vending machines a third party venture? Do you get any cut of those profits?
They are a third party venture, and the rule is that all vending machines, we have to get a percentage of, and we're the only ones that can get it. If let's say a sports team wanted to put a vending machine in so that they could offset their costs, it's actually a mandate, a regulation that is not allowed. So the food service program does get it. I'll give you one quick example. One of the food service vending machines for one of the bigger months, made about $900. And we got a check for about $80 of that. So we get a very small percentage.
So I'm wondering, I guess the question is, like, I know other schools, I think even Smith Volk, they set the vending machines so that they're not functional during school hours when the cafeteria would be open so that they wouldn't be in competition with you. Can you do that?
Yes, we can do that. They won't be in competition with us. I mean, we'll have enough product available at a price point in which if they buy from the vending machine, they'll be spending a little bit more than they should. And I'm going to make sure that my staff all understand to be friendly, to be welcoming, to make sure that when they, I'm telling you, when you see how the server is looking, they're not going to want to go to a vending machine. They're going to want to come into this area. One of the other items that we did is on either side of the serve lines, we mounted small flat screen TVs. And either one of those TVs is going to have information about menus, nutritional item or information, and then miscellaneous other pieces of how's, you know, the chicken of the day being cooked. What's it really look like? What's it look like as it's being prepared? So the students, as they're standing there in line, they can see, wow, that looks good. Like, that's that now. So I wanted to bring the technology up a little bit higher. When you go into a place like a Dunkin' Donuts or other miscellaneous place, you see all those big TVs that have all this fancy stuff, and you just stand there like, huh. Of course, you can't order anything because you don't know where the menu items are, but you just look at it and you say, oh, this is great. Mine's going to be very informational. It's going to be, I feel it's going to be exciting for the students to actually see. And we're going to continue. That was the first step. We have some other pieces planned in the future, but we wanted to start with that side of things. So,
good question as well. I think Ms. Fallon brought up a good point in regards to competition. And so I do know that there's an open campus part of the high school where students are actually able to leave during the lunch period. And so you're always going to be in competition with those kids going out. And so I think the idea of making it a really welcoming place to keep them on campus would be great. I also know that there are some issues of just food being delivered into the high school as well. And so if kids aren't leaving, they're still getting food that's coming into the high school. And maybe that's something that we have to look at as a district as to whether that's going to be in competition with food service or if that's a practice that should be continued or not.
Yeah, I that was one of my pieces that I should have done some more research on. I would like to actually find out whether or not there is a regulation that states that an outside vendor can't deliver food inside the campus. I know that you can't set something up a few hundred yards away, but I'm not sure of the piece of having something dropped off because it may fall under any student can bring in what they'd like to have for lunch, but how it gets there, there must be something in place. I'm just not sure yet. That's something that I'll get back to you on. But I will honestly say that looking at the quality of food that we currently serve and have served, we need to improve that. And we know that. And everyone who's ever seen school lunch programs understand that. But we have a lot of commodity items that come in either fresh or, you know, we have a good example is these chicken strips that come in that are fresh white meat chicken strips. If you look at them, if you thaw them out and put them in the oven, they taste exactly like chicken breast. I'm going to do things like the buffalo wraps that some other places around do and some other places. I've been traveling around quite a bit to all the different, say, restaurants, fast food places to see what they're offering, to see what the kids are doing. And we're going to try to also compete with them that way. Because at a price point, we can, with government commodities price point, we can always keep it substantially cheaper for those type of items for students. If someone wanted to buy, let's say, a buffalo chicken wrap and it's $2, and we're still making a 50% markup on that, that's gonna beat them from going someplace else. We just have to make sure that the quality's there. A big piece of making sure quality's there is my office currently is at JFK Middle School. That's where I spend most of my time. Last year I got out and about quite a bit. What I decided to do, because this project, I believe in it so much and I wanted to make sure that it was going to work, I actually moved, I'm gonna move my office up there myself 3 days a week. I had a computer installed in the office up there. All my files will be accessible there. And I'll actually be able to spend time with the staff, making sure that it's working, with the students getting out and talking to them. I love to get out and just sit at a table and talk to them. They all look at me like, what are you doing? But the students that I did that with last year, a few of them, every time they came through the lunch line, they remembered me and started talking with me. So if I can keep getting information from them to open up that communication, we can start creating more and more as we go forward. So that I'm very excited about. The big piece is trying to get encourage them to use the cafeteria for what it is, a place for food, good food, and a place that they can come down and relax away from everything else that's going on. And hopefully it'll keep them within that area from what our design and plans are. Another piece that I started last year is improved dietary restriction offerings. We have a lot of students that have celiac disease, dairy intolerances, miscellaneous other allergies or intolerances. We started slowly introducing product last year for those students. And I did it on a small scale. I didn't do much advertising with it. And we started the year with one or two students, ended the year with probably about 12 students that we were getting specialty foods for. Doesn't impact what we do, it doesn't impact the service or flow, but it gives parents an option because more and more students are coming in with these type of restrictions, and I think that it's an important piece for students to feel that they can sit down at a table and get school lunch or come to the school lunch line, especially at the elementary level. I hear that quite a bit where parents get excited because we have these offerings. We're going to continue to make sure that we have offerings, more and more come out all the time, and this year I'm actually going to advertise it on my menus, that we have this, and on the website that we're offering these items, and also talking more and more with parents who we have one-on-one interaction quite a bit with, working with the menus to make sure that it happens, to make sure that they're safe. A lot of people feel that, is there cross-contamination? Is it being handled properly? Is it the accurate? I can guarantee them that it will be handled properly and managed properly. And there will be offerings that students can have, not just your basic. So as we start to move forward, I thought that was just an important piece of where we're going to be looking in the future, but what I also did this year. So I'm hopeful that parents will see this, see the menus, see the website, and say, thank God, it's going to be a good thing. In closing, our food service program staff and myself is excited to see how our new initiative, creative ideas, and continued departmental growth will impact the new school year. I'm really excited about this year. I was so excited that I went out and I had these nice shirts made up for myself. So I wanted to make sure that I looked sharp along with the staff. So again, thank you very much. Do you have any questions for me?
It's not a question, it's a comment. Parents have been coming up to me and telling me how happy they are that they can go to you and say, my child has celiac, and you have been really responsive to them, and you know how anxious, you know, parents who have children with food allergies, how anxious they are about the safety of their children. And so when they talk to somebody like you who's just really understanding and immediately helpful, it just is a great thing for the whole school district. So I can't thank you enough for that. And then my second thing was this issue of that we need a charge policy in place and we don't have one, and that's hampering you and when you get evaluated. I'm not exactly sure what do we make a motion or how can we refer that to rules and policies? Does it have to be on the agenda, this, or can we?
I think you could just take it up.
That I was going to bring up, but okay. You're welcome to address it now if you'd like.
So can I just move that we refer to rules and policies developing a charge policy for food services?
Second.
Okay. Any discussion of that? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, so we'll get working on that.
Well, I was going to ask, when we schedule that meeting, would it be helpful, obviously, to have... So we'll be in touch with you about scheduling that.
It'll be my pleasure. Thank you very much.
I have one other question.
Sure.
Before you put your notes there away. And it had to do with, the uncollected debt.
Yes.
And so just looking at the chart, and I'm trying to wrap my head around how it actually works. But I mean, the fact that we have accumulated debt of over $8,500 in the last couple of years, and I know that debt now has been moved over into the school department to wipe clean the food service accounts for the students. You did mention in your comments that you want to continue to actively make it known that parents are still responsible for that debt. However, you'll be working very diligently to try to minimize the amount of debt that would be incurred in this fiscal year. I'm wondering if our business administrator or in conjunction with you and food service will continue to work, reach out to those families to see if we can recover any of that debt or how that might work.
Absolutely. I have Excel spreadsheet that I moved all that information over to. I still have all the list of the names of the students, and we'll still be working from the high top down on trying to collect that debt as much as possible. Some of the families, you know, you reach out phone calls, send certified letters. We've done quite a bit, and I'll continue to do that. And what I've seen just today is I still get small amounts in. It's always the smaller amounts. I did get a check for $200, so it was somewhat one of the heavy hitters. And all that compiles together, becomes the credit for the end of next year's school debt. But we'll keep working with families and trying to work out what we can do for them. I think the discussion should even be brought a little bit further of, I personally wouldn't want to say, okay, we'll do a payment plan. Like, what can we do to work with you? But it might be something that we can discuss in the future to say, okay, if it gets to this amount, this is what this is a structure that we can work with you on to try to get that accomplished. Some students that end up getting a higher debt within a year or even in the future will become free and reduced, and they just think it's now gone. But any debt that they have that occurred before they were qualified for free and reduced is the responsibility of the parents. So I think that's a key to eventually slowly keep talking about and to let parents know that's what happens.
Two points to that. One of the things we started doing last year, and we did more of this year, is we asked the principals to get involved with contacting those families, because they're the ones that know the families the best, more so than John or anyone in my office would. So we've asked the principals. We provided them the list of who does have uncollected debt. The other thing that we'll have to tackle, shall I say, going down the road, is there's probably 12 or 13 families that represent probably 75% of this debt. So the small ones are coming in, or some of those small ones will be settled when kids come back to school, but the larger ones are the ones that are probably not going to be settled, and that's the piece that we've got to keep figuring out strategies on. Last year we offered payment plans at one of the schools. The PTO offered to split and pay 50% of the cost if the parents paid the 50%. The principal had one-on-one meetings. Some of the parents signed agreements, and there was very little follow-through in payment. So we've got a small group that we have to find some other strategies for.
And this is usually from full-paying parents or students of full-price lunch?
Most from the full-paid students. It does represent some students that are on reduced, that is 40 cents a day.
Right.
We have some that haven't paid it in years, the 40 cents, so that it builds up over time. And then there, again, like I said, there are some that haven't qualified for free and reduced until a certain point. Up until that point, they started to accrue debt, they fill out and they finally qualify, and then they feel, you know, that they don't pay or that they're free. So they think it just goes away. Trying to get the parents to understand that is the tricky piece. So
I'm also curious, since you said that, like, there might be dribs and drabs coming in right now, I'd imagine, have the accounts been zeroed out already for this coming year?
They have not.
They have not.
They
okay.
will, as soon as I do my rollover on the point of sale system, we'll clear those out. I'll create a new chart that has the accurate data on there, and then we'll move forwards from there. Because once it's cleared out from there, I then have to look over at the Excel spreadsheet to see where we're at. And it is simple enough for me to say, John owes $20 on the Excel spreadsheet. What does he now owe on the POS system? Combine them together to send out a bill as we move forwards.
If I may just ask a clarifying question to Mr. Zuchowski's point. If I can take you through your uncollected debt chart,
sure.
Table on page 2.
Maybe you can do a better job.
Yeah, go ahead. So as I read this, last year, this food service department ended with a deficit of $4,600 that was covered by the school department.
Right.
And then late collections in the next line, in the second cell, is $2,300.
Correct.
So about 50% of the debt that was covered by the school department at the end of the year was later collected by this food service department after the fact. Is that correct?
Correct.
And that was used as a credit against this year's unpaid debt.
Correct.
So is it fair to say that the same process will continue next year with the $6,200 that we'll continue to try to collect that debt? And
absolutely.
Anything we get will be a credit towards next year?
Absolutely. So I hope that this chart doesn't get bigger and bigger, but yes.
Any other questions about the program?
We have to do a vote on the participation in the National School Lunch Program.
Okay.
It's a routine annual vote.
Yes. So as part of tonight's report, we do take a vote to participate in the National School Lunch Program, and I'd entertain a motion to do that.
Motion to continue participation in the National School Lunch Program.
Second.
Okay. I assume you support that.
I do support that. Okay. Thank you.
Excellent. All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, so our participation continues. Thank you very
much. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Have a great evening.
Next item on the agenda is the 2016-2017 student handbooks. And I see we have Principal Madden and Associate Principal Malvezzi here. And do you want, are they going to make a presentation? So I'll turn the floor over to you. Okay.
Good evening. Thank you for having me. I'm Celeste Malvezzi, Associate Principal at the high school. Thanks for having me to present the ever-exciting Student Parent Handbook. It's always a great time of year to be able to come and share with you all the exciting changes that we've made. this year, I know everything was distributed, a copy of the revised handbook and a copy of the changes. I'm also going to present the middle school handbook. I'll start with the high school.
Yeah. Just ask a clarifying question.
Yeah.
So in our email, I saw the elementary handbook, but was the middle school and high school handbook included?
In the first one from
Friday?
Was that Friday?
Mm-hmm. It was. They were.
All right, go ahead. Sorry.
I think many of the middle school changes, and I think even the elementary school changes, were more district changes, so I might be able to kind of cover those up front, and Sarah will help when she gets up here. So, I'll go through quickly what the changes are. I know you've had a chance to look at them, and feel free to jump in with any questions or comments, typo corrections, anything like that, all is welcome. Or you can wait till the end, whatever feels comfortable for you. No major changes, no major policy changes at this time. So I'll go through in the academic information. We did add the new wellness and PE requirement that's happening at the high school that was already approved, just to have that stated clearly in the handbook. There's some misinformation in the handbook around GPAs. I think that's one thing. As you keep going through each year, you start to sort of hone all the little discrepancies or things that pop up along the way. So always trying to clear things up, make things accurate. We added a statement about incompletes, and that was in response to finding over time that students had incompletes on report cards or transcripts that never, teachers may have offered grades at some point, but there was no process for requesting incompletes, no deadline really that was set or followed up on for that work being completed and then a grade being entered and listed on a transcript. So part of our practice, as we've been going along, we've been adding those changes, but wanted to make that clear in the handbook. Also, last year was a pilot year for the Lens 21 program, so there's some new language in there that just updates where we are with that. Some minor language changes that really just aligned with the program of studies, clarified some information with our withdrawal procedure, withdrawals from classes. The students have a certain amount of time to make schedule changes or come out of classes, and then really what the impact could be after a certain time with putting a W as a grade, a final grade, having that show up on the transcript. You want to make sure that students and families are well aware of that in advance during the scheduling process. And along those same lines with advanced placement courses, so clarifying the expectations that students are expected to take AP exams, and we have mostly semester courses at the high school on the block schedule, but some of our AP classes are full year, Then we've run into some situations where students were looking to come out mid-year of an AP class, and we certainly don't encourage that. That is, the policy is that students have to stay in for the full year, and it's a two-credit class, and so you only get the 2 credits at the end of the year when it's completed. The attendance policy did not change, but we did add, we didn't have any language in there about the school choice program, so that was just an addition. In general information, some information about electronic devices was more of a statement that we discourage students from taking videos or pictures of others. That's always an issue that pops up. Attorney Jenny Tate spoke with her about that, and she was saying it wasn't clear, there's no clear law against that in the circumstances that we see, but that we should discourage that. And certainly if something comes up that links taking pictures and it is discriminatory or, crosses into any of the other infractions that students have, certainly we would deal with that. But just in and of itself, taking a picture, we certainly don't want that to be the practice and discourage that, all things considered. We added a gender identity statement that I believe is in all the handbooks now regarding transgender and gender nonconforming students. And with that, I should just say that throughout our handbook, I went through and tried my best to make all the language gender neutral in the handbook, just as a step in that direction. So I was worried that I was going to get a lot of, grammatical checks back around the he, she's, and the they's and theirs, but I tried to be very mindful of keeping the language gender neutral and ignoring all the little green squigglies that came with that word. But I think, I'm really excited about some of the changes that we're making and along the lines of supporting transgender and gender nonconforming students, so I was happy to do that. The only change in extracurricular activities is that we, are instituting a student union, which replaced some of the language around the Student Advisory Council. Karen Jarvis Vance gave us a lot of language, updated language and policies in the health services area. So there's nothing new in that, but she updated some of the language that went into all the handbooks. And I think kind of across the board, some of us had some outdated policies that were still in our handbooks. So the idea was just to make sure that everything was up to date. Let's see. There was a new, if you want to call it a section, but some information that was in the code of conducts around violations and penalties that talked a little bit about, or specifically about administrative authority to use discretion to show or demonstrate the circumstances that we use, things that we consider, trying to offer more transparency for students and families around how we come to consequences for discipline. Also listed sort of a, like I said in here, a non-exhaustive list of possible consequences. Also in the code of conduct, all the language that said, or most of the language that said minimum suspension or any of the consequences that listed a certain amount of days for suspension, I changed the language to potential suspension. Again, along using our real practice, which is, a situation occurs, we handle it, there's a lot of factors. No two situations, discipline situations or incidents are ever exactly the same, and we do consider a lot of different factors in making, deciding consequences. And so I didn't, to be sort of stuck in that something is a minimum or a maximum is not really our practice. We certainly have general guidelines and we have precedent. And so we will use that, but we wanted to make that process a little bit more transparent. It also aligns with the new chapters 37H and 3/4, which when we do suspensions, we are to give a potential amount of days for a suspension, and then we hold a hearing, and not until the end result of the hearing do we actually give the actual days of suspension. So it also buys us some time in that process as well. We updated the non-discrimination policy, the parent guardian rights under Section 504. This next section is mostly Karen Jarvis Vance again with the bullying and harassment. And then we added the physical parts of the physical restraint behavior support policy that was done last year. And that's really it for the high school. Go for it.
I'm trying to find out what Mr. Travaglia was presenting, but
oh.
I just found under lunch program.
It says very clearly in bold. I know.
In bold. Students are not permitted to have food delivered to the school, so is it maybe a problem of enforcement?
So, as many things are and can be, I will tell you that there are not delivery people coming to the front door and dropping off, you know, pizza or sandwiches that students ordered. We have tried to, it certainly came to my attention that there was like a back door that a lot of food was coming in, and so we tried to, look into that and put an end to that as much as possible. Can I say that it never happens? I can't. You know, they figured it out. It's a sort of an awkward situation when you run into a delivery person, at a door, and there's an exchange of money, and it's like, do I tell you to take the food back? Do I say, you don't pay for it? You know, like, we also are partners with a lot of the businesses, the local businesses that do deliver, and so yes, we will continue to clamp down on that. I would hope that it's, in my opinion, in my experience of what I know, it's less, happens less often than it has in the past. But again, I'm not everywhere all the time. So, and then the other, I will just say too, also what was brought up about the lunches is that this is the first year, it's been in our handbook, but this is the first year that the juniors are not permitted to leave for lunch. So that we are really excited, John's gone, but about the changes that are happening, because we think that, it's really going to help sort of, they're not going to be, they know about it, they're not going to be excited about it, but I think the change that he's making is going to really help that, and, it's really cool. We're excited about it. Yes.
Hi. Thanks for presenting this to us tonight.
Mm-hmm.
I just wanted to talk about the electronic devices policy a bit, and I know I've spoken to you about this before, but I am concerned and continue to be concerned about how, from what I've heard of my, not just my own experience, but from other parents and in talking to high school students about how much time our kids are spending on their cell phones during class on non-academic or education related stuff, like texting, Snapchat, and playing games.
And with their parents and guardians as well.
Right, exactly. I learned the hard way. I could text my daughter any time of day, and she probably would respond.
I bet she would.
Don't text her during the day.
So, yeah.
Her device was away. But I just want to say, I think it's kind of interesting to look at what you, what's written in the policy about it's important for students to learn how to appropriately use this technology, because I think this is a very tough task we're putting on our kids. I think many adults, probably many of us even in this room, have a hard time managing our technology, and I think that we're not really doing a service to our kids to send them out into the world. They're going to get jobs where they're not allowed to pull out their phones. They're going to go to college where they're hopefully not allowed to pull out their phones. But yet in high school, we expect them to be able to show that kind of self-control in the classroom. Not to mention we have a tardiness policy. We have a very strict absentee policy. But we can't come up with a policy around cell phones being used in the classroom, where we don't have to put it on the teachers, because I think that's a hard thing to do, to say that you have to police all the time or take phones, I know is a very complicated thing. But, we tell our kids it's important to show up to school on time, it's important to come to school, these are important life lessons, and I think it's also important that they not use their cell phones during class time for non-academic issues, not to even mention the whole swath of kids who don't even have smartphones or cell phones. And, so when kids are, I don't even know what we do when kids are using them in a class. Some kids can have a smartphone, they can use it for an academic purpose, and other kids don't, but that's, I guess, a whole other subject. But I'd like us to think about, a creative way that we could actually, change the culture. And I don't know if that it's through the handbook, I don't know if it's through a policy, I don't know what it's through, but to me, I know, you see at JFK, kids really basically don't pull out their phones. The culture is pretty understood. You see many schools across Massachusetts where it's understood you don't use your phones for non-academic purposes during class time, so.
So I think
to raise that issue.
As far as, and I appreciate that, and we have spoken about that, and you know, as far as the handbook is concerned, the policy is really clear in the handbook that students are not supposed to have their phones on in classes, that that's the expectation, that the phone gets put away, and that if it's to be used for academic purposes, it's at the teacher's discretion. So in terms of a policy, I'm not sure what more I would state. I mean, that's the ideal situation. That's what I want. That's, you know, it's read, it reads the way that I would want it to be operating. You know, I think in terms of a culture of whether or not that's being followed through on throughout the day, I think that's a whole nother story. You know, when you're talking about something that's happening in classrooms, you know, what we have and we start every year, and I will have conversations with staff around, you know, it's one of the things that staff complain about a lot is the use of cell phones in classrooms. But I can't police what's happening in classrooms unless teachers are reporting to me that they've sort of been addressing it with a student over time, and it's not, you know, to no avail. So it's really this, the conversation with staff is, you know, if this is a culture shift that we want to make, then we need to all do it together. And everybody has to be on board, and there can't be a weak link in a, you know, on the staff where it's okay that you use your phone in class or, you know, and I think there's the reality sets in where, you know, we do. I think we start off every year along those lines and just, you know, as a parent, as an administrator, it's, you know, there are things that wear you down over the course of a year. And as a classroom teacher, when it's, you know, the same thing over and over, or a lot of students, you know, it's a tough job to manage that day after day. And so I'm always happy to be supportive of staff who are having troubles or talking to students, but I'm not sure in terms of a policy that there's much that I can do about that in the handbook, you know. But I'm happy to continue having a conversation about it. Yes.
I'm just wondering if there are other parents that are as concerned as Ms. Busansky is. I mean, you can turn your kids' phones off between 11 p.m. and 7 a.m. so they can't use it. If parents were aware of the fact that they could have their kids' phones shut off during school hours,
we
could have like a seminar for parents to say, if you're concerned about your kids using their phones during school hours, this is how you do it. Because I know that, you know, the police department, the prevention coalition, they're trying to offer these sorts of instruction for these parents like me who have no idea how to do any of this. And I'm wondering if that's the way to shift the culture.
Well, I think the other side of it is I've heard that parents do want to be able to get a hold of their kids during the day. It just maybe doesn't have to happen during class. It'd probably be hard to turn off phones from 7:30 a.m. to 2 p.m. and say, you know, that's it. No, you know, not going to be able to get in touch with them at all during the,
you know, emergencies happen
through the halls, you know. So I think that's the other side that would be complicated to kind of put it back there. So,
you know, and it's, you know, again, in terms of the teacher, it's difficult to, you know, when a student's phone rings in class or something happens, they say, excuse me, oh, this is an emergency, you know. That could be happening all day long, every day, and you know, I can't leave it to a teacher to be questioning or determining, you know, the level of importance of the incoming call or text. So, you know, I think in terms of culture, if it's a shift that we want to make or needs to be made, I'm happy to have further conversations. I think I don't know another administrator who doesn't grapple with the same issues and. I don't have more to offer at this point, but I
well, thank you.
Yeah.
So I have some questions about process.
Mm-hmm.
So this is my first go around approving a handbook, and I know we're really just seeing if it's compliant with our own policies. So I looked at our policy in terms of our approval, and it was kind of interesting. And so for anybody who's interested, it's policy CHCA, but it talks about the involvement of the school council. Mm-hmm. So how is the school council involved in the revision of the handbook?
So in terms of process for our handbook, the school council each year gets a copy of the handbook, and I know Mr. Lombardi provided a copy of the handbook and then asked the school council, you know, to review it, and then they came back to a meeting with suggestions, comments, which then he passed on to me, which were then incorporated.
Is that the process at JFK as well?
I cannot speak to, I know that at JFK they present their final draft to the council for approval. I'm not sure the process for them. Sorry, I didn't ask those events.
Because the policy is interesting. I don't know if the Rules and Policy Committee wants to talk about maybe taking this on or not, but it refers to the high school and middle school ones having the school council be involved in it, but it does not refer to the elementary ones having the school councils be involved in it. And then what I thought was kind of interesting, unless I miss it, so please correct me if I'm wrong, I didn't see in the JFK or the high school handbook reference to the school council, sort of explaining what the school council is.
Yeah, it's in there for the high school. List the members.
How does it? I just didn't see it in the table of contents, and I apologize. I must have missed that first email with them. We got the other documents like a day ago, and I just hadn't.
I think it actually comes before the table of contents.
Yeah.
And also in the high school, I'll say in terms of process, that I had a committee this year made up of students and teachers, students and faculty as well, and we reviewed the sections of the handbook, and I took suggestions.
I'm just wondering if that particular issue is complicated because it's one handbook for four schools. So if you had four school councils all giving different input, how that would then be resolved? Do you know what I'm saying? That's the only potential reason I could see for not having the school councils involved at the elementary level.
I think official, am I allowed to talk? Okay. I think officially, the role of the school council, and I think we use it more broadly, is really to have input in the code of conduct.
That's what our policy states.
Yeah, that's what the
conduct,
the law of the school council, whatever that is, falls under states.
But there is information about school council within the handbook.
Mm-hmm.
That's one more question. Is it on the website? I was looking on the website and trying to find the handbook. Do you know, like?
I don't know if they're, I'm trying to picture it in my mind, if they're all together or if it's under each specific school.
I look both ways.
And I do know that it's there somewhere.
There's also a section called documents.
Yeah.
It's not under documents. That's where I first looked.
Is it under maybe the in a district section or?
I looked both places and didn't see it. I find our website to be really difficult to navigate personally. And as a parent, I find it very difficult to use, but.
Do you want me to just touch on the JFK stuff?
Yes, please.
Before, okay. The first change there, this very similar. Nothing different there. Information from Karen Jarvis Vance. The gender identity statement is the same. The language regarding circumstances and the code of conduct, that's the same. They added possession or use of electronic delivery devices in terms of tobacco products, which we added to the high school last year, which aligned with the city ordinance. Is that what that was?
What? Board of Health regulation.
Yeah. Yes. So that was where the language came from. The other policies were existing or revised policies that were just added to the handbook. They had a new lunch schedule, so revised their bell schedule. Remove what was previously there. There was gender-specific language that was removed from their dress guidelines, from the dress code. And they went along the same lines of changing minimum language to potential in their code of conduct in regards to consequences. And JFK is involved with the restorative practice model, and so, again, that really fits with their practices as well. And they added the additional electronic device language around videotaping and photographing other students.
I did find it on the website.
Right.
That's what I was going to ask. Do these ever get sent home to the families or emailed to the student? What's dissemination for this?
It's two rainforests, and yes. yes, you get them at the start of the year. And it comes with a page of I've read and sent, signature. page with the big packet of all the.
They're getting so long, I didn't know if that was still the plan or not.
I think, yes, we do have a plan. If everything goes well tonight, we start on Monday. Two copiers.
Are you going to add the associate principal name in?
That's not in school
before you print?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yes, we have the name. Yes, I'm sure she will do that, but let me make a big note of that just in case for her.
So any questions about the proposed JFK changes? Mr. Moore?
Yeah. There's a set, it's actually appeared in a couple of places. I think it came because they took a lot of the stuff, the changes that happened at the high school and put it at JFK, but they have to do with references to the school athletic teams.
Okay.
On page 12 and again on page 17. So there's some references to MIA and whatever. And while there's not really a problem, it's sort of crazy because they don't have
teams. But they do have some of the middle school athletes competing at the high school, right?
We do have one waiver
for softball.
Or what?
Yeah.
Not very many.
Well, I thought there was the question of allowing more. I mean, that's the only reason I'm asking. Right. I thought that there was the possibility that middle schoolers could compete with.
Anyway.
So can you tell me what?
Okay, on page 12, it just there's a couple of paragraphs that are about.
Which, under the health screenings, or was it?
I'll have to open it up here.
Okay. I don't even think I have that section in my handbook. Okay, maybe. I would
just
it was 12, and what was the other one?
The one was on page 12. I'll find the section stuff here. And then the other one was on page 17. It had to do with
The MIA.
It was interesting. It had to do with gender identity, but it, it was, again, referencing interscholastic sports and MIA. Rules. And then, as usual, I have a couple of things. You might want to look at the definitions of some words in the glossary that they use at JFK. Arson and gender might want to be defined slightly differently.
Okay. Yep. Nice.
Those are the main ones for the JFK one that I had. I did have a question, though. Actually, it's a general. It was sort of prompted by the whole thing about visiting at the schools. Mm-hmm. All the handbooks have policies regarding visitation, which is usually, it looks pretty clear. It has to do with people observing their classroom, either regarding special ed or about the instruction. But we don't seem to have anything about people who might be touring the school. Thinking about whether or not they want to send their child there. And if you were to, just seeing those rules would tell you that you didn't want a tour just for the purpose of seeing if you wanted to send your child there, because they're pretty, And like I said, I think they look like they've been drawn from people sending an evaluator to evaluate a special ed program. But there doesn't seem to be a middle ground for people who just wanted to come check out the school.
The name of the policy makes it sort of like, visitors not allowed.
Yes. and some of the actual details of how it goes about and what you have to specify is sort of
not
like, well, what if I just wanted to actually do exactly what the policy says you can't do, which is get a tour through the building, wander around, drop in. and I don't know that we have any district policy on that, but I think it might be something to think about in terms of promoting the schools. So that was not specifically to the handbook, but more something that was triggered by reading that.
Any other questions or comments about the middle school?
Before you go, I just want to say thank you. I know this is a lot of work, and I really appreciate it. And I do see all the school council stuff now, and it's actually on the second or third page. I just have to scroll right past it. I apologize, but we haven't had these documents for a while. So thank you very much.
Yep. Thank you.
Thank you.
Happy copies.
Thanks.
Madden. Thanks for having me. I'm Sarah Madden, the principal at R.K. Finn Ryan Road Elementary. And I know I'm always painfully honest. And I think that the high school and the middle school might have had a process. in the middle, we're just sort of developing a process to review. And I think what I'll read you what I wrote. I wanted to give you a couple of additional comments regarding the elementary school handbook. I know that Sal Cannata listed some of the changes that were recently made. But since that memo, we've also included some updated health and bullying policies. As elementary principals, we are glad to now be a coherent foursome with a unified mindset. That's certainly a shift from where we've been in the past. I'm sure that's come up on a number of occasions with the turnover and the changes and inconsistencies at the elementary school. So I think coming together with a handbook is important, but it certainly hasn't happened in the past and really has only happened in the past year or two that we've even talked about the handbook as a unified group. So we are working to bring consistency to many areas of our elementary schools, and the handbook is one that we have just recently begun revising. I can assure you that we will continue to work on improvements in clarity, content, and grammar. And any suggestions would be welcome. I appreciate, you know, particularly Ms. Fallon's efforts around this. That's very much appreciated. And I am, it takes a lot to offend me. So anything that you want to suggest would be welcome, because this is certainly a work in progress. And we are so grateful for the opportunity to make improvements to our handbook. So that is where we're at. Any comments? You can email me. You can. Yes.
Yeah, so.
I do want to, go ahead, Howard.
I just want to say that that's, since I've been on the school committee, this is, these handbooks have gotten better and better. So as much as nobody ever really reads them until their kids are in trouble or until they have a specific problem, I think it's really important for them to be good precisely because that is when people do read them. And so it's really good that we're putting some effort. And I think it's awesome that you could look at a handbook from any elementary school and it would have the same set of rules as opposed to before where what you got in terms of just general policies and things would be different depending on which elementary school your child was at. So I think that's really good. I had a couple of these kind of, you know, things. One, the on page 13, the comments about delay days, the schedule on delay days, there was a little thing thrown in about how the before school programs were included in the policy, but I didn't understand what that meant. Did that mean that the before school programs also were delayed by that same exact amount? Or in other words, so if you had a 1 hour delay, did that mean the beginning of the before school program would be delayed by 1 hour also?
So the only before school programs, yes. I mean, that is not consistent with the elementary schools because some just have the Y program. That's really not.
I understand, but given whatever the program is, so whether it's the program that's mm-hmm. the Y program or the one that runs up at Leeds, that's the Leeds program.
I think that they just are, yes. So if it's a 1 hour delay, everything's a delayed 1 hour.
Okay. See, I'd like that to be thought about because the reason people use a before school program is because they have to go to work. And people's jobs don't get delayed for snow unless they work for a school district. So
I honestly can't tell you what the why. I know that if we have math club or something like that, that would be delayed.
Right,
I'm not
right.
positive. I don't know if anybody else. Do you know what happens?
I don't do morning drop-off.
Right.
So I know that on the two-hour delays, like the district delays, like for PD, that there is no before school. Those days,
right.
But if there's a snow 2 hour delay, do you remember? I honestly don't know.
Let me send a text message.
You know, I'm there, and I've not been aware.
I don't know either. Anyway, I was just
that's a good
that
question.
Caused me to think, yeah. Think about this some more because it seemed like I was sort of a thrown in line about the before school programs, and I wasn't really clear what it meant. And then I thought, gosh, and maybe there needs to be some more thought about what it ought to mean. So,
right.
So that's
thank you.
Just something to discuss.
Noted.
This is also in the high school. And I didn't see it in the JFK one, but it's where I first saw it was in the elementary school programs. It has to do with bus behavior, and that that we will withdraw the privilege of transportation on the buses if a student does distracting behavior on the bus.
That was in there.
And I don't know if that our policy that we absolutely will, as opposed that we may.
I think in practice it's a may.
And it ought to be a may, regardless of what it says in our policy, because it should not be a will, because that just means then we'll end up ignoring what we say we will do. It says will on page 18 of the NHS one. It's the same exact paragraph, actually, as in the elementary one. So it's a great example of lovely integration.
We're working on it.
But
that's a good suggestion.
But maybe not what we want to say. Then there was a little bit of weirdness around permission to forward school records if a child is transferring to another school. On page 11, it says that you would get the permission of the person to transfer the records. And on page 9, it has already said that that those records will be forwarded without permission.
I'll look.
So I don't know, right? So to the new school.
So a parent, well, I'll tell you what we do. I mean, a parent can request to have records sent to a new school, or a school can request.
Right.
So if a parent hasn't, so say they move and we never heard from them, and then a school requests the records. The parent would have signed something at that next school. So I guess it could be either way. You know, the parent can request the records to be sent before they leave, or they are just gone and we don't, you know, we still have the records, and then at some point we might get a notification from that school saying, can you please send the records?
Okay, because anyway, what it says on page 9, it was section F, the records would be forwarded without permission. And I don't know what the rules are, but it was inconsistent from page 9 to page 11. So, and then just a question in there, I didn't make a note. I think it was on page 12. It says something about possibly notifying DSS of neglect, suspected neglect. That agency is now called DCF. Mm-hmm. So, and how this is just one of those questions that was sort of triggered by the thing. The preschool hours of 9:00 and 2:50 for dismissal. How do those work with the regular school people coming in and dismissal in terms of the traffic and things?
So I've not been at a school with preschool.
Right.
Okay, then I'll ask you.
Sure. Yeah. We stagger the start?
Yeah.
So
it makes sense.
It's about a 5-minute stagger. I believe it is the regular day students arrive first and debus, and then the preschool students come in and debus.
Is it enough? That's why I work.
Well, I would venture to say that although with the exception of RK Finn Ryan Road, parking is an issue at all of the elementary schools, but probably the worst at Bridge. And when I've been there for the preschool arrival or dismissal, it seems to go as good as could be expected around that little island in that the spring can be interesting to travel.
Right, so that was my question. If 9:00 was enough later than when all the rest of the schools arriving and dropping off and leaving, just basically was not a question again for the handbook, but a question for planning for the future.
I did hear back about warning, snow issues. It's delayed by the same amount as whatever school is. Mm-hmm. And if the school gets out early because of weather, there is no after school care.
Can I make a point of order? I don't think we have the authority right now to be correcting the minutia of the school handbooks, do we?
I'm not correcting it. I'm just making suggestions.
Right, and so whether maybe there's a process, because we probably all have suggestions. I have some, and I'm not sure that's what's on the agenda tonight. It's for us to provide all of our suggestions, and whether maybe we ought to talk about what the process should be. If maybe we can. I don't know what it is. Should we be putting an email to you?
I'd be happy to receive any emails with suggestions. And all.
I'm just asking what our process should be here.
Yeah. I'm not promising that I'll make all those changes. I will talk to my cohesive group, but that could possibly happen.
Just to answer that question from the perspective of policy, as has already been brought up tonight, it's the school councils that are empowered with the creation of the handbooks. The school committee is required to review the handbooks to make sure that a school council doesn't insert something that's contrary to one of the school committee policies. So this review is really to ensure that there are no conflicts. Now, any member is free, I would say, as someone who's reviewed this, to give individual feedback on the documents before they go out. But the purpose of the vote tonight is to get the approval that nothing within the handbooks contradicts school committee policy.
Ms. Fallon?
I think the only thing I'd found that was not a contradiction, but we had recently renamed attendance officer the job title. And so that was something that I guess was within our, I don't know that we alerted you to that fact when they were doing the handbook. So that was really the only change that I think was on our charge.
And we do, I think this is the same with all the elementary schools. I could be wrong, but we don't print them and send them home. I put something in our newsletter saying that it's, and it is on our website, and that there are paper copies if anybody would like one to please call. And I've had two parents request a paper copy in the 3 years that I've been there. And that, you know, that seems to work pretty well. And I'm hoping that you use our website, because I'm hoping our website is user-friendly.
I remember reviewing it when I was looking at the school.
So I think it's pretty clear that it's there. And so I don't think all the elementary schools, I don't think any of us send it, but I can clarify that if you want to know. But we just felt like it was really not necessary. And when issues come up, we don't, you know, parents are directed to it, or we send something. So that seems like it's worked well for us. But.
So have you used the school council to
get? So the school council always looks at the handbook and gives a feedback, and not just policy-wise, but any sort of feedback that then we consider and we'll make changes going forward, you know.
So I guess in going to Nat's point about process, I don't know if we want to refer our policy to the Rules and Policy Committee to consider including that elementary schools should include the school council. It was odd to me that that was left out of that policy. So I will leave it up to people who are on the Rules and Policy Committee to decide if they want to refer it to themselves.
All of the elementary schools have their school councils review the handbook.
I just had a question. I don't know where it fits into whether it's a conflict policy, but I just noticed the buses being equipped with cameras is a new part of the handbook. Has that always been the case, or is that a new?
That's new. So okay. That was an addition. And
it's not that we just didn't have it in the handbook. It's actually something new that is now happening, that mm-hmm. school buses are equipped.
I don't know how many.
We've had the cameras, and there's signs on the buses, but we were advised to put language in the handbooks
okay.
also.
Got it. Thank you.
And I've reviewed them on multiple occasions. Actually, it's a handy feature. Yes.
Okay. Any other questions about the proposed revisions to the elementary school handbook? Okay. So I guess I see a vote. So I guess the vote is, it's not really a vote of approval, it's a vote. Approving it for the purposes that does not conflict with our yes. with our policies. So if someone would like to make a motion to approve the three handbooks.
Yeah, I'll make a motion to approve the three handbooks for the 2016-17 school year.
Okay. Any further discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. Thank you both for being here. Next item on the agenda, we have a memorandum of agreement with NACE on the second year of a full-time release from teaching for the association president. And we're going to request a motion to approve this MOA. Dr. Provost, you would be subject to.
There's one tiny last bit of due diligence that the school committee attorney is looking into. She has reviewed the language of this MOU or MOA and found it to be acceptable. But there's a question about the process in general that may require some reflection, may not require to be reflected in the MOA either. Just we have not heard back from the appropriate state agency. So I guess what I would be requesting is approval of this MOU reflecting the discussions in the last meeting, with the provision that if that state agency responds negatively, that I would not execute and bring it back to you with any required changes.
So someone make that motion. or say so moved?
So moved.
Second.
Ms. Judd, did you get the gist of that?
Yeah.
Excellent. Okay. Any discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. So that, again, MOA is approved, subject to that review by legal counsel. So the next item on the agenda is we have, speaking of Rules and Policy Subcommittee, we have second reading and vote on several policies, and I'll turn it over to the chair to walk us through those.
Okay. So all three of these policies that we learned about last month, the changes are essentially based upon the changes that have been made to the city charter. So in the first policy BB, school committee legal status, the changes reflect the fact that all school committee members are now elected for two-year terms, and that they are no longer staggered elections, and how vacancies occurring on the committee will be filled by the joint ballot of the city council and school committee. And so, as this is the second reading, if we're going to vote, if no one has questions.
Okay. So, you'll move the policy for a vote?
I would recommend, yes, that we change policy.
Adopt the policy as amended.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's the word I'm looking for.
Okay.
Second.
Okay. Any further discussion on this particular policy? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, so that policy revision is accepted. Next.
This is also a second reading and vote. It is policy BBBE, unexpired term fulfillment. It's essentially removing the first, most of the second, the fourth, and the fifth paragraph, and just saying that when a vacancy occurs on the school committee for any reason, that the vacancy will be filled by a joint ballot of the city council and the remaining members of the school committee, and gives very little information other than that about how the president of the city council will call a joint meeting, choose a person, and that no vacancy will be filled if a regular city election is to be held within 120 days following the date the vacancy is declared to exist. So once again, this just reflects changes to the city charter, and I would move to accept this policy as amended.
Okay. Second. Okay. So there's a motion to accept this policy with the revisions, and any further discussion on it? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Yes.
I'll speak louder next time for okay. The clerk. Sorry.
Okay.
And then the final policy we'll be voting on tonight is also a second reading. It's policy BID, school committee member compensation and expenses. It is also being changed due to changes in Northampton City Ordinance, and reflects the fact that school committee members will be receiving an annual stipend of $5,000 per year, with that large school committee members receiving $5,500 per year. And yeah, it's pretty straightforward. So I would move to it that we accept the policy as amended.
Second.
Okay. any discussion? I assume we all support that. Okay, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. So those three policies are revised, and thanks again to the committee for working on those. Next, we're turning to a discussion on the literacy coach, and I'll turn it over to Dr. Provost.
Thank you. I will also reference the job description for the literacy coach, which comes up as the next item in the agenda, just to talk to you about the strategy moving forward on this. Our curriculum director has wanted for, I would say, about a year to develop coaching positions for the district, both in ELA and in math, because one of the problems that we have with our current coaching model is that it relies on teachers taking time out of their classroom to coach other teachers, which we will release teachers to do, but it's a burden. Because it means not only are you coaching, but you're preparing for substitute teacher in your classroom, and then you're sort of gathering up the class after you return to the class. However, we were not able to see our way to do it in the FY17 budget. However, we began discussions about possible uses for our Title II funds, which are funds that may only be used for professional development. Currently, we use our Title II funds to provide mostly literacy professional development, but also professional development in mathematics and some other areas. As we were looking at the grant allocation this year, we started to just wonder if we did not use the consultative services, could we insource coaching? And I think there's enough money in the grant to give us an opportunity to make an honest go at trying to insource our literacy coaching services. Of course, that would mean that we would no longer be doing basically any of the consultative services. It's a trade-off that was discussed with the administrative team, and they were in favor of giving it a try with the understanding that if we don't find the right person for the position, that we'll continue with consulting, because we don't want to fill the position just to fill it. The professional development we provide, we think, is very important for teachers, and we wouldn't want to sacrifice what we consider to be high-quality consultative services for mediocre in-house services. So in order to do that, we need a job description for a literacy coach, and that's the next thing that comes up on the agenda. But the discussion here really is the strategy moving forward is if you approve the job description, we would post and see if we can find someone who we think can do the job. If we're unsuccessful in that, then we'd continue to use our Title II funds in the way we have been doing up until now.
Any questions about that particular Dr. Baird? And then
so I just Dr. Chivas had reached out to me. We had chatted about trade-offs with coaches and not having coaches. I have experience working with coaches and really like the model a lot. I think it's really grounded in research. In our conversations, Nancy had like a clear vision for how she sort of sees this expanding over time, and with, you know, if the budget can support that over time. I'm very excited about this move. I hope that we can find the right person. I think it's gonna be difficult having one person stretched thin. So that's just the thing. We have to be something, you know, cautious about what our expectations are for this person. But I think it's a great move moving forward. I think it's a good idea in terms of how to use Title II funds. And so I'm really excited about it. I did express some concern about some pieces of the job description, not enough concern that I would say we shouldn't pass it, but you know, having specific language about Atlas or weekly or daily, like, that's concerning to me, because I think that's not realistic in some cases. And like, Atlas could just not exist in a year because they don't support it anymore, you know? So that's my only concern about the job description.
Mr. Reed?
I also echo what he's saying about what a great move this is. I think we ask so much of our teachers. We're asking more of them all the time. Differentiated instruction, we all know, is essential and really, really hard. And to sort of ask a teacher to, I've heard teachers describe shifting to real differentiated instruction is like moving from one moving car to another while driving. I mean, it's just asking so much. And I think the districts that really implement great pedagogy and great DI manage it because they have coaches there to support the teacher. So when the teacher wants to really have four small groups doing slightly different things in their classroom, they need somebody to stand with them and both show them the techniques and maybe help them get the materials together. So I think this is a great thing. And of course, the research, like Tom said, you know, PD without coaches, you get a 5% transfer. PD with coaches, you get up to 95%. So it's a really, I'm really excited for how this is gonna take the money we do spend on PD and really make it work. And then the only other point I wanted to make is that in other districts I'm aware of that use coaches, they don't necessarily find somebody from outside who is has been a literacy coach. They're often able to take master teachers from within their own building, give them the next level of PD, and then they can become that coach for their peers. And so maybe that might be an option, as well as finding somebody from outside is sort of, you know, enhancing somebody from within. So anyhow, just thank you so much for doing this, and I can't wait. So.
Any other, sorry.
Two quick things. I agree about I love this, but the Atlas Rubicon stuck with me, and you have it as a qualification, and you also have it under preferred competency, and I just like it under the preferred. It just seems too specific for a definite qualification, but that's minor. And then the second is, will Dr. Cheevers be the supervisor of this person?
Yes. Great.
Would you want that in here somewhere, that the... I couldn't, maybe it's there.
That's a point in authority.
Does that need to be in there?
I think that would be a good addition.
Okay.
Reports to line.
Dr. Baird?
So one of the things that Nancy and I had talked about was how this person's going to use their time. And this is like, over a month ago that we were chatting about this, I think. So I didn't know if there was any more clarity on that. I mean, do you see this person spread across all four buildings, or having the data sort of drive them spending more significant time in one or two buildings?
Our first cut at this is one day a week in each of the elementary buildings. We do want to expand to sixth grade eventually, but the first thought is one day for each of the elementaries and a day to meet with Nancy to report. This is where the weekly language comes in, But, I agree that on a regular basis would, provide more flexibility. But
to that, one of the things says daily in the classroom. So if they're spending a day with Nancy, then that's
right.
They're not going to be daily in the classroom.
Right. Yeah. So the idea is one day a week at each of the elementary schools, and then a day to consult with Nancy.
Any other questions about this?
I just have a question about do we have a sense of how teachers will receive this or respond to this? Or?
All I can tell you is that the association has seen a copy of the job description and hasn't protested. I think that there are some trade-offs for teachers as well. I think that teachers will, at the elementary level, get more support in providing reading instruction and writing instruction. I think that if we find the right person, that will be well received. I think that at the other levels, teachers are not going to have as much support for professional development because we'll be spending our money this way. And I do think that may be a little bit of a negative with this plan, but all of the principals have professional development money within their cost centers, as you know. So I think they'll be able to supplement what we would be directing towards this this process. But I, as someone who also has worked with a coaching model in other districts, would say the reason I keep saying it depends on the right person is, think of your own experiences with any coaches, even athletic coaches you might have had. Some of them are really able to motivate and bring out the best in their players or their teachers. Others don't have that skill. So for me, I'm looking for someone who not only understands a Readers and Writers Workshop model, but understands how to work with teachers.
Thank you.
Yes, Ms. Bosansky.
Just curious, am I missing it? Does it say somewhere in here that it's for gonna be working with the elementary schools only?
It does not say that specifically.
Does it say six in here? Okay, I just missed it. Thank you.
Okay.
So I guess, do we want to change it? Do we want to take out Atlas? Do we want to change the daily or weekly?
Oh,
or do we want to just let it go through with that?
If I can speak to that, reflecting on our discussions we had about this, I think it's the two good changes would be to change wherever it references a specific schedule to just regular schedule, mm-hmm. and change references to specific software programs to the district program.
Yeah.
Okay. So those would be modifications that you would accept. Okay. So could I get a motion to approve the job description as revised tonight with these discussions?
So moved.
Okay. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. Any further discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, so that description is approved as revised. We now have another job description for after-school enrichment program coordinator.
And this continues in the path of trying to standardize practices between schools. As you know, we have a number of different types of after-school program models. We have after-school coordinators, I believe, now at four of our schools, and with the NEF grant that Bridge Street obtained this past grant cycle, we'll hopefully be going to an after-school program at five of our schools. The after-school coordinator position has never really been defined. So one of the work, part of the work that the Bridge Street group did with their, as part of their grant allotment, was to develop a job description for the after-school enrichment program coordinator that they hope to put in place in their school. I'm bringing it to you for your approval for that program, but also for the district, because I think that it will help to sort of explain what it is that we want after-school coordinators to do. With this one, I pointed out, this is the one that I sort of stripped away some of the original language from. I think it's very ambitious that they're looking for someone with a bachelor's or master's degree for the after-school program coordinator, but it is a preferred skill or experience. It's not a required skill or experience. So I would just point out with this that it would not present an impediment for anyone who's currently serving as an after-school coordinator who doesn't have those qualifications, or anyone else who we may want to put in as an after-school coordinator because we think they're the right fit, but who may not have this level of education from serving in that role.
Okay. Any questions about this position? If not, I'd entertain a motion to approve the job description.
Move to approve the job description for the after-school enrichment program coordinator.
Second. Seconded by Ms. Fallon, or Ms. Fallon, tell. Okay, any further discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, so that job description is approved, and now we'll move on to a discussion of substitute rates for non-degreed student teachers. Again, I'll turn it over to Dr. Provost.
Thank you. This one is a little bit of a tweak to our current practice that I'm bringing before the committee because I think it may help with our substitute coverage, and I think it would be a good thing for students. The rates we have for substitute teachers begin at the bachelor's level, which means if someone is in a pre-service teaching program that has a practicum at the bachelor's level, they're not eligible to serve as a substitute teacher when their cooperating practitioner is out. So it leads to a situation where a student teacher is supposed to be learning from a cooperating practitioner, and we're calling in a sub to cover the class. Now we have the student teacher working with a substitute teacher. Don't think that it's really a valid learning experience for the student teacher, and I don't think that a sub just responding to ASOP is necessarily going to have the same kind of sense of continuity of the class, the needs of the students in the class. And so I think in that specific situation where a student teacher's cooperating practitioner is out, we should allow that person to substitute in the classroom. And the rate I would propose for that is $70. It's a little bit less than we pay for our substitute teachers who have a bachelor's degree. Not every teacher prep program will allow it. Some of them say, we want you to get the sub because we don't want a student teacher taking over. But in my opinion, that's between the cooperating practitioner, the principal, and the supervisor from the college. And for the programs that allow it, it allows us to get a few more subs in, and I think we should go for it.
So is it my understanding that if a cooperating teacher wasn't comfortable and wanted another adult in the room, a substitute would or could be called in?
It's not automatic. It's just opening up an option. You know, if a substitute teacher or if a cooperating practitioner is sick in the first week of somebody's placement, they probably would, you know, think maybe the student teacher's not ready to take over. But, you know, as you know, at the end of the practicum, the student teacher is really supposed to be in charge of the class anyway. So I think if you're in a, if you're with someone who has been there long enough to kind of know how to run a classroom, it would help. I think it would be a good move both for the kids and for the student teacher.
Yeah, I do too. Did this come from student teachers, or is something that you've been thinking about? I know it's practiced in other school districts as well.
This actually came from a principal, and it was not for bachelor's level teachers, because I'm not sure. It started with a misunderstanding, I think, of our practices. The principal actually had someone in an MAT program, so it was a teacher who already had a bachelor's degree who she wanted to call in as a sub because she knew that her teacher was going to be out for a couple of days. And she said, that's not allowed, right? And I said, well, I think we can pay them the bachelor's rate. They haven't earned a bachelor's degree. And I think we should do something for teachers who may not even have the bachelor's degree, not to sub generally anywhere in the school, but to sub for their cooperating practitioner.
I think this is wonderful. The only concern I have is what you alluded to at the beginning, which is if it's their first week, that I think it, as long as it's really clearly communicated to the student teacher that this could happen, because I can imagine that there might be some student teachers who actually are like, whoa, I want this job in there. So, but I'd like this.
So this isn't something you're asking for a vote?
Just direction.
Have a discussion, yep. Okay, and just get some feedback, and yep. Sounds like people are comfortable with it.
Mm-hmm. So they get registered as like a sub would through ASAP?
Yes. Yeah, well, they go through HR. They already have the Quarry check as part of being student teachers, but we put them on payroll, we'd set them up.
I can't imagine them not liking to get paid every once in a while for a day's work.
Sure.
I know this is, I'm preaching to the choir here, but I just think it's such a shame that we pay our substitutes as little as we do. I mean, it's not really a living wage, and I know that's, we don't have enough money to do what we have to do, and this is the problem with the state not bringing in enough revenue and then passing it on to us. But I if we ever sort out the state revenue problem and have more money, I would love for paying substitutes a living wage or a higher wage to be a high priority, because I do think that it affects the classroom experience. So,
okay. So the next item on the agenda is a vote to accept a gift. This is from Clark Art Institute, $1,100 to JFK for field trip busing. Ms. Walczyk?
Yes, they agreed to underwrite part of the cost of the transportation to the museum for trips. We're asking that this be deposited into the student activity account because the rest of the field trips was actually paid by student fundraising. So this would put all the money in the same place to cover the bills.
Okay, so can I move that?
Sure.
So I move that we accept with gratitude the gift for tonight from Clark Institute for $1,100.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, the gift is accepted. Next, we are requesting a vote to amend the FY17 budget. And this is to reflect an additional appropriation from the city. And I'll turn it over to Ms. Walczyk.
During the budget process, the mayor had committed that if additional Chapter 70 aid came into the city, he would recommend it be appropriated to the school department. So that did indeed happen. It was actually able to happen at the time that the city council voted the entire budget. So we had voted one number, the council went ahead and voted the
actually,
higher.
It didn't actually. We just came back and asked for a supplemental. We didn't put it in the budget. Okay. So we did actually just do an order recently to appropriate the new money. Okay. So
we have that funds now on the city books sitting in basically a holding account, and we need to appropriate it into line items within your budget. At the same time that the legislature was increasing the Chapter 70 funds, they eliminated the full-day kindergarten grant, and they eliminated the MCAS remediation grant, which was for the high school. So what we're proposing here is that we transfer the bulk of this money into the accounts that we need to cover the kindergarten program that would have been grant covered, and that $7,000 be directed into the high school account to pay for the MCAS support that would have been covered by that grant. That leaves us with just under $40,000 remaining, and we're recommending that that be transferred into special ed non-public school tuitions, which is our largest special ed tuition account. The account numbers are listed here for you, and if this is approved, we'll actually go in and modify the budget and get you new copies.
I make a motion to amend the FY17 budget as presented.
Second. Is there a second? Okay. My only comment is just, you know, there's a lot of taking victory laps around the increase in Chapter 70 that the legislature approved, but when you read the fine print, they, you know, eliminated some other funding, so it wasn't exactly, you know, it was good to appropriate this money to the schools, but, you know, in with one hand, out with the other, with the kindergarten grants going away, so it's kind of frustrating in that regard.
To express gratitude to the other side of our city government for working so closely with us.
Okay. Happy to do it. Okay, so all those in favor of accepting these changes to the FY17 budget, these amendments, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. Next item, the business administrator report.
Yes, it's got a number of things on it for you. You received the final Munis City Accounting System report for the fiscal 16 budget, showing that we were able to bring the school department budget down to zero, so all of the appropriated funds were used. And then I gave you highlights of what I call our major five revolving accounts, the ones that probably represent about 90% of the money in revolving accounts. Gave you the status on each of those. I can answer questions if there are any, but I know it's getting late and warm. Also made mention that due to the city's capital project for new telephones, we're getting really close to the new phone systems going in, not just in the schools, but citywide. The wiring and everything is in process, and we hope sometime in September to have that change over to the new phones, and mention some of the benefits to us in terms of the elementary schools being able to call out from the classroom to 911, and also being able to have recording on certain telephones in the district so that if there are threats of any sort, we'll be able to get those calls recorded. It's going to be a great security improvement for us. Mention here that we have a legal settlement bill that will be coming out of the school choice balance. This was something that just came to fruition as the books were being closed. So we outlined here how we'll be taking care of that. And then also summarizing the FY15 carry forward balance. When our books are closed, there's always purchase orders that are open. We essentially have one more year to get delivery in and pay off those bills, and then at the end of that year, the money reverts back to the general fund of the city, and that amount this year that is being returned to the general fund is just under $13,000. Most of that is due by price changes on orders that were done. Periodically, something is not available that we ordered, but more often than that, it's discounts and price changes on things that we ordered that we find out about after the purchase order has already been issued. Any questions on any of that? Quick report with a lot of money.
I had a question in regards to just athletic revolving and the numbers there, and yes, with the amount of capital that's now in revolving account with some of the projects that you're hoping to get done, and whether these projections, the projected amount of money that came in that we were, I guess, unexpected, or we did not expect. Do you see that in future years we'd be looking to continue to do more projects like the ones listed here? Or I know we've been raising the athletic fee, and I've talked to several parents just this week as they're getting ready to register kids with the, I don't know if it's a concern, but just the cost of the fee, and if we seem to be doing okay, is there any consideration to revisiting the fee structure and bring it down so that we're not bringing in so much over what we need to run the program?
We did talk about that with the athletic director this week as we looked at the numbers. There were a couple of things we discussed as we went through that. We would like to see a couple of years of history with the athletic director to see if this holds or if this was a fluke. This was a new athletic director who came in and streamlined a lot of the processes, actually held off on some purchases that some of the coaches had wanted to make because she wanted to see how the budget came out overall. So whether that will continue into the future, we're not sure yet. But we did talk about the fact that if it does continue, that would be something to consider. And hopefully some of these projects we want to tackle as are listed here, as they're tackled, the list of things to be approached. And future years would also be going down so that we can furthermore just consider decreases in the user fees.
I think that would, it's, you never hear of things going down, you know what I mean? And so if there is a way in which some of these things that we've looked at in order to kind of shore up budgets and now we've found new ways to do it, if there was any way of being able to return some back to the folks that have paid it, I think it's at least worth considering, that's all.
Okay, thank you very much for your report. Personnel report, I know is included in our packet.
Probably the biggest piece on this is the new associate principal at the high school who started, Lori Valancourt, is on board with us. For separations, we've listed for you four teachers and six ESPs that resigned during the month of July. Not unusual in a school department to have that turnover in the summer. There were two transfers of people between positions. And then you've got a lengthy list of the summer school staff. That program did end at the end of July, but this is our first meeting to give you a listing of the full summer school staff.
Thank you very much. I know now Dr. Provost is going to give us an update on the refugee resettlement effort that the school department's been part of.
Thank you. This is a story that begins last December with the Northampton City Council resolution. Quoting from the resolution, Northampton is committed to serving as a place of sanctuary and refuge for refugees from around the world, and still quoting here, urging city departments, local businesses, and charitable organizations to provide shelter, sustenance, and other service for refugee families relocating and integrating into our community. There's much more to the resolution, but this is from the concluding sections of it. About the same time, the U.S. Council of Catholic Bishops Migration and Refugee Services was tapping Catholic Charities of Springfield to take a lead role in resettling refugees in Western Massachusetts. As you may know, the State Department has been steadily ratcheting up the number of refugees that it will approve for resettlement in the United States. There are 9 agencies that the State Department contracts with in order to resettle refugees, and they're called VOLAGs. I love that word. It sounds like Voldemort or something. But the Catholic Refugee Services is one of the VOLAGs for the U.S. So looking at rising numbers of refugees being resettled by the State Department and the Catholic VOLAG being expected to take on a large part of that, there was a desire or a need for local affiliates to become more active in placing more refugees. So it, you know, in a coincidence, the Catholic Charities of the Springfield Diocese was sort of being tapped and asked to place more refugees. Northampton was saying, we welcome refugees. And so the discussion began for how we could partner to serve the need of sort of living up to the vision that the City Council has set forth, and also serving the needs of the relief agencies to find suitable housing for increased number of refugees that will be emigrating to the U.S. At that time, a resettlement steering committee was formed. I sit on the resettlement steering committee, which meets frequently, including just today. And I chair the school working group that's been formed to advise on issues related to the education of school-aged refugees. Some of you have been present at some of those meetings. Some of you were able to attend the administrative retreat where we had further discussions of the refugee project. For those of you who haven't been a part of the project yet, I just wanted to share some facts with you. First, the Northampton application is for 51 refugees, which is the minimum number that the State Department will assign for resettlement to a host community. Our refugees are most likely to come from the Congo, Burundi, Afghanistan, and Syria. I say most likely because one of the things that's been consistently communicated throughout the discussions is that a resettlement agency can request families from certain groups, but can't make impositions on the UN Commissioner for High Commissioner for Refugees, who is the individual who's in charge with actually assigning refugees to countries. So we may not get those groups, but it's likely that the individuals we'll receive will be coming from those communities. Families will likely begin arriving in November or later, and this is a one-year federal fiscal year cycle, so the refugee resettlement needs to be completed by the end of September of next year. As I said at the retreat, for those of you who are there, learning about refugees and learning about their needs has been an important part of my own professional development over the summer. I've been spending a lot of time on the UN's YouTube channel. They have a channel where you can visit virtually different refugee camps, get a sense of what the experience is like. The other part of that work has been trying to learn through my work on the Resettlement Steering Committee. One of the things that I asked for as a part of that committee is if we could have more communication with other districts that have had recent experiences resettling similar communities. And so they've connected us with the West Springfield Public Schools, which has much larger refugee population than we're likely to receive. Also to hear from some of the refugees themselves, because I think that people always run a very grave risk of wasting a lot of effort and being counterproductive when they decide they're going to help someone else, but they don't ask the other person, what would you need? So I'll talk a little bit about what I've learned from the refugee I've met just today as sort of the ending of this. So Catholic Charities has asked us to identify a list of needs to help accommodate students and their families. We're working as an administrative leadership team to get that list out. I'll be sharing that list with the school committee and the city council. Because after all, this is their vision that we're really kind of on the front lines of trying to enact. And so I hope they'll be open-minded to, you know, helping us actually accomplish the mission. And it's something that I would say that in my own experience, working through the resettlement group, and then also sharing and preparing my administrators. It's a process that is sort of mixed fear and hope. I think we have some trepidation going into this. A lot of the trepidation is around newness, but we also hope that we can do this well, because I think that the refugee families that will be coming to Northampton deserve our very best. And I think that if we do this well, you know, it really will be a blessing for the whole district. And so, you know, it's new for us because I think it's been a long time since the Northampton Public Schools has been involved in a focused refugee resettlement effort. The last time I was involved personally in refugee resettlement effort was back in the Rwanda Civil War, so that was a while ago. I think a lot of the people who have those memories may not necessarily be with the district anymore. But when I think about the challenge that the newness of this brings to us, the thing that I keep coming back to is it's not just going to be our first time trying to do refugee resettlement, it is the refugees' first time trying to be refugees. And the changes we have to make are nothing
compared to the changes that refugees are asked to endure. So just sharing some quotes from Susanna, who is a refugee who was resettled in Springfield, who I had an opportunity to speak with a little while this afternoon. These are just some of her quotes that I think really struck me as how jarring and disorienting the whole experience of being a refugee is, and really kind of provides me with motivation for us to make the changes that we need to make in order to be accommodating. So she said, quote, "When I left the camp, I was scared because it was the first time for me to fly." Now, so this was an individual who had fled her country for fear of her life, who is now in fear of her life again because it was her first time flying. Then she talked about coming to the United States, walking through the airport, and saying it was scary to see so many white people. It was just complete culture shock. Then she talked about the resettlement group met her at the airport, brought her to her apartment, and kind of left her there. And she said, "Well, this is great. They gave us a house, but we didn't know how to use the stove. We didn't know how to turn on the shower. It was just completely foreign to us." So I think this is going to be a hard adjustment for us, but whatever changes we need to make are just absolutely nothing compared to the changes that the folks we will be serving have had to endure. And so my best thinking about what we can do to prepare ourselves for the process is to just really be open to new relationships. You know, I know that language is going to be a really important educational goal for our students, but our kids are going to pick up the language quickly. And I'm not concerned about our teachers' ability to make connections with kids. That's what they do. That will be fine. But what I'm concerned about is, as a learning community, how do we open ourselves to relationships with the parents? I want to make sure they don't become isolated. I want to make sure that they're not, you know, scared because there are all these white people around, or, you know, scared because they don't know how to operate the appliances in their home. They don't know how to make this crazy institution that we call school work for them. And one of the things I've learned is that the isolation that parents go through in the refugee process can be a much different experience and a much harder experience than the challenges that kids face. So my update on that is, and my thinking on that is, we need to start, I think, with the goal of making our schools hubs for the new social networks that our refugee parents will need to make. Oftentimes we talk about building up social capital for kids, and we do that. You know, they make friendships that sometimes, you know, help them get jobs later on in life and all that. But I think in this case, we're going to have a special mission as a school district to make sure that our schools can become places of connections for our parents. So that's really all I have. I'll be happy to answer any questions, although I don't really have many answers. As I said, it's our first time doing this. It's my update on refugees.
Okay. Any questions or comments before Ms. Fallon?
I did get to attend two meetings. I just want to say, I don't want to keep testing it by keep throwing these sorts of things at you, but I've been so impressed with how, no matter what we throw at you, you rise to the challenge. Like that leadership retreat, you really led. I mean, you really did lead by example, and you didn't dismiss anyone's fears. You completely acknowledged them, like, yeah, this is. But you've just served as such an inspiration, I think, to so many members of the community, and I can't tell you how much we appreciate it. And I really do hope that we don't keep testing you on it, but it really, it's been, your attitude is really, truly inspiring, so.
So next would be the superintendent's report.
Thank you. During the school year, we work to improve our schools by working in areas such as curriculum, instruction, climate, and culture. But summer is the time to upgrade physical plants. So my report for you today will just be a listing of what was accomplished this summer and what's still to do in terms of physical plant and providing resources for learning for our students when they return.
John Tranfaglia has already talked about. The facelift at the cafeteria at the high school has received. I haven't actually been there, but I've seen pictures, and I will attest to what he said. Looks great. Creating that less institutional, quasi-college type of eating experience, I think, really will resonate with our kids. It's really just the first phase. I'm glad that we're kind of doing this in phases because we'll have an opportunity to get feedback from the kids and what they like and what they don't like. One thing that I don't think he spoke to much, but is part of this idea, is to improve outdoor seating. So now I think we have a couple of picnic tables, but we have that whole area overlooking Healthy Hill that is potentially available for outdoor dining. So I'm interested to see where that will go. We're finishing the gymnasium floors at both the high school and JFK Middle School. The middle school floor should be done for the opening of school, and high school floor should be done before the winter sports season. We'll probably be doing outdoor physical education and refinishing the high school gym while school's in session, because that money became available a little bit late in the season and all the refinishing companies had already sort of committed, but we will be able to get that done before basketball. We've also completely renovated the high school softball field, raising its grade. If any of you have been down there after a rainstorm, you'll know that it was below grade. It was underwater at times. I learned that one of the groundskeeping techniques at the softball field was to dig a hole and bring out a sump pump and pump water off the field. So that won't be happening anymore. The softball field's now above grade, and the infield has been filled with proper conditioner so that it will drain quickly. We've also put some reinforcement around home plate in the pitcher's mound, so hopefully batters won't be able to dig in so destructively. We've done a near complete renovation to the high school field. The baseball field was in better shape. It was already on proper grade, but it had a lot of uneven places. So there are many areas that were resodded. The areas down the foul lines received special attention this year. So that will also look good. And I have to say, without breaking the budget or breaking the bank on water bills, they've managed to keep the sod alive through this drought. So I'm very happy about that. Resurfacing work starts at the tennis courts and the JFK outdoor basketball court next week. So that also will be done prior to school. As many of you know, we actually had to take our home meets on the road this past season for tennis. Smith College was kind enough to help us out with that, but we'll be back on our home turf next spring. We'll also be deploying 225 new computers for the start of the school year. These are not replacements, these are additions to the fleet. This will significantly equalize the availability of digital learning tools throughout the district. You may recall I had presented a chart, it was around December or January of last year, with the computers available in each school and a computer to student ratio. So this investment brings the schools much closer to parity. So most of these computers will be going to the elementary schools. A lot of them will be going specifically to Ryan Road because that was a school that was kind of behind on that. So with that new deployment, we'll be up to 750 desktops and 850 wireless devices available in the district, which is pretty much almost 2-to-1. So that brings us to the next concern. So I've been thinking a lot about what happens when all these students try to turn on their new computers. We authorized a transfer for potential disaster recovery because as teachers and students become more dependent on digital learning devices, it becomes more problematic if there are problems with the system. So we have really started in a very serious review of our technology infrastructure. We have a consultant who's in right now who's evaluating all of our servers, all of our wireless networking, the configuration of all of our products. Some of that work is going to have to wait until the fall because part of the process involves metering the network at different nodes to see how much data is flowing through and see if there are any bottlenecks. Right now there should be no bottlenecks because it's only really administrators who are around. But when, you know, these
1,500 or 1,600 machines are all trying to access bandwidth, it may be a different story. So we're looking at that very closely. We do have a plan in mind that involves a series of graduated adjustments to different types of devices that will be implemented immediately if we encounter connectivity problems. We've also made some contingency plans to purchase emergency bandwidth on a temporary basis if we need to. And we've also begun sort of having the discussion about whether coaxial cable is going to serve the district's needs in the long run. I think that it's very likely that it won't be too long before we have to make the move to fiber. And so we've begun some very preliminary discussions looking into that. So we should have some good redone surfaces for physical education, some really improved services for food services and for athletics, a lot of new digital learning tools in the hands of kids, a plan to make our wireless system more robust. So I think we're in pretty good shape to open school in a few weeks.
Excellent. Thank you. Okay. We do not have any new business this evening. Future business and meeting dates, we have the negotiating subcommittee meeting on August 19th. That's a Friday, 9 a.m., JFK. Rules and Policy Subcommittee, August 19th, 2 p.m. in the superintendent's office. And then our next regular school committee meeting will be September 8th, 2016, right here at JFK Library. I would now entertain a motion to adjourn.
Move to adjourn.
Is there a second?
Second.
Please, somebody. Second. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? That concludes our meeting for August 11th, 2016. The meeting is adjourned.